Come to order, please. Welcome back to our 10 November meeting. I'm going to now turn it over to our county administrator, Dr. Bridget.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. First, Commissioners, I turn your attention to the draft agenda for November 17th. You begin your morning at 9 a.m. with a joint commissioner meeting with the Metropolitan Commission. It is to be held at the Metcom offices. Then you resume your meeting at 11 a.m. here for your business portion of your meeting. First on the agenda is the public forum for the Board of Education vacant seat. That is scheduled to start around 11:05. Then you also have at 2:15 scheduled for the my office, Office of the County Administrator, to review the final decision on the nonprofit policy. You also have scheduled an executive session to review personnel and litigation. Also that afternoon, you tentatively have scheduled the decision on your Board of Education appointee. 6:30 p.m. is a joint legislative public meeting. Just a reminder, Commissioners, there's no meeting scheduled on November 24th, 2015 due to Thanksgiving. Today's business meeting begins with item B, the Department of Public Works and Transportation, the resolution to provide for storm debris disposal. Presenting this morning is George Erickson, Director. Good morning.
Morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, George.
Good morning.
What you have before you today is a resolution. This resolution is something that we have in our debris management plan already. It's an update to a prior resolution, something that we like to have in place in the event we have a serious winter weather or a summer weather event. This is good. The debris management plan is good for any type of adverse weather condition. But this is typically for our hurricane season, which is between June 1 and October 31st. What the resolution does is it authorizes me as a director of public works for an initial 3-week period to begin certain things as part of the recovery process. They're pretty standard. They've been proven over time in our plan. Basically 5 items: to collect storm debris from coastal flooded areas where we provide roll-off boxes and we collect mattresses and debris from within the homes, curbside collection of yard waste, which is a typical thing you see afterwards, extended hours at the landfill, days of pickup in various areas. Also, the opening of yard waste collection and burn sites, which you authorized about a month ago with the approval of 4 burn sites for these operations, and also the distribution of ice and water by emergency services and technology. Included in your package is also an estimate that I did on October 1st, just before Hurricane Joe Quinn missed us. And at that point in time, there was a path that had, it wasn't the European model, but it was a path that had us headed right to the brunt. Between Patuxent and Potomac, there was a path, and I did an estimate. That estimate said that we could anticipate to be in the 2.9, 3 million cubic yards of debris. We could anticipate that amount of debris. Most people didn't panic at that. If we all recall Irene, I did a similar estimate back in Irene where we estimated about 115,000 cubic yards of debris. We only ended up handling about 50 or 60,000 tons because the Category 1, when I did the estimate, was downgraded to just above a Category 1. This was a Category 4 estimate. So you can imagine what Irene was, what kind of devastation this county would have had. And what we did behind the scenes, we worked with Bob Kelly in finance. We had a lot of things in place ready to go. We had POs and PRs. We had 30 100 cubic yard trucks ready to roll from South Carolina. We had met with the emergency services folks. We had the burn site ready to go if it hit. Fortunately for all of us, the storm took a offshoot or a different path, the European model path, and all we got was a lot of rain and a lot of wind. But we take this seriously. Really what this does is it provides the citizens as well as you all with an understanding of what we're immediately going to do no matter what. And in this particular case, obviously, we would have been in a position to do yard waste collection. We would have activated all of the burn sites. In fact, we would have needed more had we been hit. But the first 30 days is critical because FEMA has a little formula, reimbursement formula. On day 0 through 30, you can get 85% reimbursable rate. The plan that was just reapproved, I think we sent the commissioners a memo. We just got our plan reapproved. We got an extra 2%, so that would be 87%. In days 31 through 90, you only get 80% reimbursement. And in days 91 through 180, you only get 75%. And we'd have 2% more tacked on top of that. Point being, the first 30 days is critical. If communities such as ourselves have our act together, and we're able to respond on day one or day zero, and we're ready to go, which we were in this case, we'd be in a really good position to capture a lot more reimbursement than we would otherwise. This is just a part of that puzzle. It's worked for us before. Wanted to thank Bob Kelly here at the table, because there's a lot of stuff that we do that is invisible to sometimes even ourselves. I hate to say that. There's a lot of stuff that goes on in preparation for these storms. And wanted to thank him for all his efforts, because he conducts these dry drills once or twice a year, whether it be radiological or hurricane. He does those drills, and I think they really help us hone our plans and keep them up to speed.
Good.
So that was a long-winded version about what this really does. We'll take this resolution, and actually I'll incorporate it as an appendix to the plan next time we update it, so that we just keep the plan current. It's really just a part of that process.
Yeah. Questions, anybody?
Just curious real quick. I was looking at the map, and I noticed that Pax River is outside the map, which makes sense on one level because it's a federal facility and it's not under the county control. But do we have some sort of partnership with a major catastrophic storm like the last one that we just missed? If Joaquin had really hit us, is there some agreement on how we would work with the Naval East?
We would develop one. I talked with Captain Fleming just a couple days ago. We're trying to renew some partnerships that used to exist. We had a lot of MOUs for solid waste and debris removal and a lot of sharing. All those MOUs disappeared over time, and I reached out with her this past week, and this would be part of that discussion. But she wants to re-engage the county, as do we, with some MOUs that would solidify that. Federal government would stand on its own. There's not a lot of stuff from the inside that they would bring out to us to take care of, so it would probably be a self-contained unit. So the answer is probably for disaster, there wouldn't be a lot of partnership, and if we had a Category 4 or 5, the county probably wouldn't be in control of the recovery effort. I think there would be a National Guard and some other folks that would have to come in and take over for us. So I think it gets a little gray when you have a high caliber storm, and in the smaller caliber storms, we both take care of our own separately. But certainly we ought to keep the doors and windows open for any partnership, especially in an event like this.
Thanks.
Sure.
On the burn centers, I know after Irene hit, tough over there in Hollywood, as it was throughout the county, and we were told that we couldn't burn. If we could rake it, we could burn it. If we couldn't rake it, we had to haul it. Now, with that being said, what is the citizen able to do when they have like a major event like that? Can they burn the debris in their yards, or do they have to take it to these burn centers?
I know Bob's back there. He might be able to help, but there are individual permits that you have to acquire. The town is different than the county. You have to make sure the health department, the fire departments are aware of what you're doing. I burn in my yard. It's a legal thing to do.
Illegal for you to do?
It's legal.
Oh,
it's legal to do. There are certain times that you're allowed to do it. In a disaster situation, though, I think it depends on the declaration of emergency, what you can and can't do, and I think it varies each time. If there's a ridiculous quantity of debris, you don't want people burning in their backyard, because there's a potential for the balance of the debris that's still out there to catch on fire. And there's an impossibility for the fire departments to be able to respond. So unless Bob has something additional to provide, I think it really is a case-by-case basis in an emergency situation. But the burn sites, they're geographically located, be pretty convenient. One of the issues we have is that you can't get there, and that's why we always offer the curbside collection, because most people can at least get it to the curb. And we'd rather they bring it to the curb and let us burn it in a site that's designed for it than to have them burn it on their own.
Okay.
But I'll also follow up with the specific requirements that individuals have. For example, today, what would be the requirement today?
Well, I just think it would be good if you could maybe make some kind of a public announcement, some kind of notice. You know, this hurricane's coming. If you get hit hard, this is your remedies. You know.
When we activate the burn sites, whatever the declaration is at the time that pertains to that, we put that into the press release.
Good.
So that they know.
Okay.
So we've got it covered. That's why I said it varies, but we make sure that we include that, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions?
Mr. President, I move to approve the resolution to provide for storm debris disposal.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any nays? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you, George.
Next on your agenda is from the Department of Recreation and Parks, the budget amendments for Project PL 1603, Clark's Landing Boat Ramp. presenter this morning, Brian Lowy, director, and David Guay, their parks manager. Good morning.
Good morning, commissioners.
Good morning, Dr.
Brian.
Mr. Guay.
We are here today to present budget amendments to one, to close out a portion of the roadway base widening repairs project. That's Highway 1507, and transfer $250,000 to the FIN 16 capital reserve account. And two, to transfer funds and appropriation authority in the amount of $250,000 from the FIN 16 capital reserve to the Clark's Landing Boat Ramp Project, PL-1603. A little bit of background there. It's a new project to design, engineer, and construct a replacement boat ramp and related amenities. It's estimated to cost about $250,000. Funds are being transferred from the roadway base widening and repairs project, Highway 1507. The public boat ramp at the end of Clark's Landing Road is in need of replacement and additional parking. We're talking about a new boat ramp, a finger pier, a floating dock to provide some safe public access and as well as be ADA accessible at the end of the road. We've had some previous discussions with the adjacent landowner to secure an area for additional parking. They have been unsuccessful at this time. The engineering and survey work for the project will determine if there's an existing roadway that can be widened for additional parking in this area. This allows us to set this project up. And as Dr. Bridge said, David Guyther's here with me today to answer any additional questions you may have.
Okay, I got a few for you. First off, I want to thank you for taking this seriously and looking at it, because that is a safety hazard down there. Now, we have had discussions with the property owner down there, and he does not seem to be receptive to wanting to be involved, even though I think it's to his benefit. But I need to ask this question. They're concerned, those property owners down there, about how many people would be able to use this, say, for crabbing or for fishing. Would this pier be such that they could use it for other activities other than boat launching?
Well, I can tell you at some of our other facilities where there's no actual pier, it's just a finger pier for the boat launching facility, that there are times people do come and crab and fish off of those little finger piers. We do have signage up stating must remove crab lines and fishing lines when someone's trying to launch a boat or retrieve a boat. But it's not something that we advertise that, hey, you can come on down and fish off of this little finger pier. People just do it.
Well, the concern is you get someone either coming in or going out, and there's someone doing some activity that's permittable. You know, I'm a big fan of that Woody Guthrie thing, this land is your land, this land is my land. It should be open to everybody. So with that said, what about maintenance or people? Because there's one person who lives down there said he's actually taken that pier on and he keeps it clean and he does the debris and the trash. And hey, look, good on him. Do we have a system in place that we go down there and do this kind of thing?
Yes.
Okay, so we would do that. We would provide a trash can, yes, per se, and we would provide trash pickup.
Yes.
All right.
Usually, what, Mondays and Fridays are
Mondays
typical
and Fridays normally.
That we hit the piers and the landings as
okay.
well as public parks.
Do you know how many spaces you'll be able to get out of this for a vehicle and a trailer? Because we know that's essentially like two or two and a half spaces. And if people want to come down there and just use it recreational for crabbing or fishing, that would only... Do you know how many parking spaces we'll be able to create?
I think that's what the surveying engineer is going to tell us, if we can widen that road out any. Right now, what are we looking at? Four to six boats?
Maybe around four on that right side. And as far as any designated parking for ADA accessibility, there is none right now, as you well know.
Yes, I know.
And I would think that... we would have at least one space designated for ADA parking. Because it's such a small facility, you probably wouldn't have more than just one space for ADA.
The key gets to be is the number of people who can use it. What I've heard a common complaint at Forest Landing off of Sodley Road is, if you're not there by 7 o'clock in the morning, you don't get a space to park your boat and trailer. So it does early bird gets the worm thing. So hopefully we can get the maximum number of spaces out of this when you're
That's
done.
That's what we'll shoot for.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
Mr. President, I move to approve the budget amendment closing out a portion of the roadway-based widening and repairs project, number HW 1507, and transferring $250,000 to the FIN16 Capital Reserve account and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents. And I move to approve the budget amendment transferring funds and appropriation authority in the amount of $250,000 from the FIN16 Capital Reserve to the Clark's Landing Boat Ramp Project, number PL1603, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Mr. Lowy, I just wanted to thank you for your efforts on the Three Notch Trail publicly. I know a lot of people are watching. It's had a lot of positive results with the actions you've taken so far. So I really do appreciate your team's efforts. It's making things a lot easier. Thank you.
And now you're making out them horse diapers you've been
We'll let you know.
Item D, Commissioners, is from the Department of Aging and Human Services, the Maryland Strategic Prevention Framework Grant Application. Lori Jennings Harris, Director, Cynthia Brown, Manager, the Human Services Division, and Mary Ellen Kreese, Treatment and Prevention Specialists, are presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, ladies.
Thank you, Dr. Bridget. So this application is from the Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, and we were notified in July, our department was notified in July that we were one of 10 counties invited to submit an application for additional funding to help support and continue our alcohol prevention efforts in the county. The initial award is for $60,000 for administrative costs, and we anticipate a supplemental award to support the program initiatives. I asked Ms. Kreese to give you some background on the initial round of funding for the prevention efforts, and then we'll answer any questions you have.
Good morning. The jurisdiction's first MSPIF, as we call it, was the first to turn in and be approved for their required strategic plan and was invited to present the details of the plan at the Maryland Association of Prevention Professional Advocates Conference in October 2012. And other activities that involved St. Mary's County staff included serving a statewide work group to develop the underage drinking video, Be a Parent, Not a Friend. And in March 2013, participation on the panel, and on November 2013 was the MSPIF symposium to discuss sustainability strategies.
Thank you. Any questions?
Questions, anybody?
I move to approve the Maryland Strategic Prevention Framework, MSPF2, application project number US1624. From the Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, Behavioral Health Administration, on behalf of the St. Mary's County Department of Aging and Human Services, in the amount of $60,000 to continue alcohol prevention efforts in the community.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item E is from the Department of Emergency Services and Technology to review the network infrastructure upgrades for historic St. Mary's City. Presenter is Robert Kelly, Director, Emergency Services and Technology, and joining him is Regina Fadden, Executive Director for Historic St. Mary's City. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
That's 5 minutes later.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. Before you this morning, seeking to obtain approval for funding to install some burial-grade fiber to critical buildings and some networking gear to connect historic St. Mary's City to the county's iNet, which would basically be leveraging our existing Metrocast cable franchise agreement. The Director of Historic St. Mary's City, Regina Fadden, is here, and she can answer some specific questions if you have.
I would say, what about state funding?
We have pursued state funding since I arrived 7 years ago, and it has been more and more challenging to get resources from the state. And so we have tried the Department of IT, we have tried Department of General Services. I understand that I'm asking for county resources, and I wouldn't be here if I felt there was another option. We have been lobbying, and just, I mean, as I said, the state resources are very tight as well. And I understand that question, why I'm here. But I see us as partners in the community. We bring in $3 million into the county every year in payroll and services and goods that we purchase. We also generate another $1 million, I see, for food service and other ancillary goods and services that come from events on our site, from bringing people into the community. And if we don't have the cabling, and I have 75 jobs depending on me and others, you know, depending on me that come forward and find the resources to do our business, we are not going to be able to take payment. We are not going to be able to operate. And we have had the cable go down on Labor Day, and we weren't able to take any payments. And that's when I asked Mr. Kelly to help me with a solution. So I understand that I'm asking for resources for a state agency. But again, we are partners in the economy here. And we are asking for some very critical help.
That's a good answer.
That's very solid.
And Commissioners, I would also add that there's in-kind services that Historic St. Mary's City is providing to the project because of the historic area that's down there. I don't have the expertise on disrupting that property, so there's archaeological work that needs to be done as part of this project. So there's almost just over $15,000 in-kind services that Historic St. Mary's.
Are you going to be able to bury anything down there without digging up a piece of pottery or something?
Well,
I know it's sensitive.
You're serious.
It's a good question. It's a very legitimate question that was part of the project in establishing the path and where the cable will be buried. We're essentially going around the property line as much as we possibly can. The areas where we are in the historic area, there's archaeological work that needs to be done prior to us building burying the cable. So that's a very good question.
So my question is the $95,000. So we don't know how far the cable might have to actually run. So
0.8 miles.
How long?
0.8 miles.
Right, but when we're doing the study, it might get diverted from a certain area, go longer. It might, you know, there might be a piece of pottery in the way, so we might have to go outside of that way. Does it make more sense to do the archaeological portion first of where we're going to run this and then say this is how much it's actually going to cost?
Part of the project that we've done to date identified the one specific area of concern, and it's actually at the corner of the parking lot is the best way that I can describe it. All the rest is in the existing right-of-way for the roads.
Okay.
So that was part of why the delay in bringing this forward is to make sure that we had those areas identified, and then the quote that we received from Metrocast for the installation takes into account that.
And have we done everything we possibly can with Metrocast to get this price down based on our franchise agreement?
Because this is not a location that was specifically identified as an INET location, it's really very gracious that the franchisee, I think that's correct, yes, because we would be the OR. So the franchisee, for just the cost of installation, is all they're really charging us. What they're not charging us for is the rest of the mileage of fiber from the junction road, the road all the way back up here to our campus.
Okay, that's what I want to make sure, that portion of it. So there's a larger cost savings that came along with this because of the franchise agreement.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Does this also then provide a backup also for the college's internet service instead of Metrocast too?
So the existing connectivity that Historic St. Mary's City has right now is through the college, and the problem is some of that infrastructure that's on the property is old, and quite frankly, it's just not burial-grade cable. So it's been broken, it's been cut, it's been repaired, and there's some uncertainty as to how much more degraded that it would allow it to go. So in discussions with your staff, the short answer is yes. It can provide an alternative route for the college to get connectivity through Network Maryland using the path that we're establishing. So yes.
Thank you.
Has any of this been presented to our present delegation or senator?
We have
addressed this to them.
Absolutely. So I've
got letters to them.
I've had meetings with them. I have asked through. I have testimony through the Department of General Services.
You had meetings with Delegate Ray, Morgan.
I've talked
O'Donnell.
To Senator Waugh.
I've talked to Senator Miller about this.
Yes, and I've talked to President of the Senate Miller about it, and we have made our plea for years. And
what was their answer?
What was their answer?
you have to go through the department that helps us. And so I talked to the Department of IT, and they said, we can do this for $75,000, but we don't have $75,000. So we have been, and it's the only way for the delegation, the assembly, to do this. They cannot put money in our operating budget. As you know, in the state, they can only cut from the operating budget. And so it's also a challenge for them to help us in those capacities. And so that's where we do get assigned. We have an ability to go to the Department of General Services, which the college can't do, but many agencies can. I just have to tell you, I don't complain to other state agencies, because DGS will tell us. We used to be able to go out and do maintenance plans and work with the agencies, and now we're really on a crisis management basis, and this is the answer I'm getting from the state. So unless there's sewer going in the river or some health and human services problem going on, we are not able to fund it. And it doesn't mean that they're not good people up there and they don't want to do their job. They don't have the resources. And so that's the answer that I've been getting over and over again.
One of the things I may say is, how critical is it, one, that we approve this today for you?
Well,
as far as what you have with the franchise agreement?
Well, I would really have to defer to Ms. Fadden.
We have tried to test the cable, and this is one other thing that the state is asking us to do. Tell us that you've tested and tested and tested, and we've done that. We have brought people in to test the cable. You can't even get it all the way through to test the integrity of the cable because it was household grade, like 20 years ago, shallow buried in some places. You can kick it around in other places, and we're about one groundhog short of losing our connection, which we did on Labor Day, which really kicked us into high gear because we have a very tenuous connection. And it really is, without the internet, I mean, with my staff being cut 20%, we've been turning more and more to technology to be able to do things online, to book things online. And that connection, as you know, I mean, if we can't take a payment and we can't schedule a tour, we're back to paper and we're in a cash economy. So it's critical from my standpoint.
What I'd be proposing is that we do have a meeting with the delegation on the 17th.
I think the problem, though, and this my perspective only, is she's absolutely right. The delegation can't add money, so you'd have to go through the executive level to have the governor put it in the budget in the first place. Then you'd have to go to the delegation for them to defend it before you could pull it. And I think we're at a critical moment. I don't think this is a huge amount of money, and I also think that they're offering to do the archaeological piece for it. And I think it's part of our economic strategy for South County because we don't have a lot. So I really don't – I think there's a little more expeditious requirement to get this done than to go through that whole process. But I do appreciate where you're thinking. I understand.
Yeah. I just wanted to give them the opportunity during their meeting to voice their concerns and say, no, we can't do this. And that's it. And then we can say, okay, well, at our level, we could do it. And, you know, we have everything already set up, basically go from there. Just give them, at least give them the opportunity to mull it around publicly and say what they want, go back and forth, maybe come up with a strategy. But at the same time, we're prepared to take action on it immediately if it is a no from their level. I just don't want to make a decision for them.
Well, I guess it's a frustrating opportunity because if you put that on their shoulders, they're going to be immediately frustrated because they know they can't really do anything until the next budget comes through from the governor, and it's no one's going to look good there. And I think this needs to be done more expeditiously. So
maybe we ask them for a refund.
Well, there we go. Maybe that's the route. I just want to make sure that
by having that conversation.
Yeah, I just want to make sure they understand that we know this is a state level issue. We're taking care of it, but
I'd be willing to fund this and then have a conversation with them offline about why did we have to go to this level.
Right. I agree. Thank you. Yes, definitely. So,
if I may, commissioners, I would just like to add that this really does take care of a problem long term. This is not a short-term fix. This will be available, a resource that they'll be able to use for 20 years, 25 years.
Ms. Kelly, tell me, what about reoccurring expenses? I'll assume you're going to have a monthly bill with MetroCask. And
absolutely not, sir. It's part of our iNet. They've already agreed to add this site location
to
our existing infrastructure, our iNet infrastructure. The ongoing cost for Historic St. Mary's City could be upgrades to switches and the maintenance of the switches. But they're
Ms. Fadden, that's something you can handle.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm all about you being able to take these credit cards or whatever because it's a taxable transaction. Not that I'm into that, but hey, look, if people want to spend money with you, look, I'm a businessman. People want to spend money with me, I want to be able to take it. Yeah. Last thing I want to be held up with is technology that eliminates me
it's
from...
It's outdated and whatever.
Yeah, we got to go with this.
Okay.
Mr. President, I move to approve the budget amendment using $95,000 for the Commissioner's Emergency Reserve to increase the emergency services and technology FY 2016 budget to install burial-grade fiber to critical buildings and networking gear to ensure reliable network operations at historic St. Mary City.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you very much. Thank you very
good
much.
Presentation.
And I hope to see you on Maryland Day when the lead coffins are back in the new crypt, and we'll enjoy the celebration
good.
Of the state's we'll
be
anniversary.
Down there. We'll be down
thank
there.
You. Thank you. You.
And item F this afternoon, Commissioners, is from the Department of Finance, a budget amendment for Hurricane Jaquan Emergency Project OT-1620. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I thought I was going to be here in the morning. I was here in front of you, I guess, the first weekend in October. And remember, we moved monies from the debt service savings to your emergency reserve. And we're not going to need all of it. We were very lucky, and the expenses that we only incurred were $19,082. So I think we dodged a bullet. And there were expenditures for overtime totaling about $18,500. But with the departments that had the overtime, they do have overtime budgeted in their department. And at this time, they're going to cover it, which, and then we'll go through, we'll do like a salary review or whatever, probably mid-year. And then at that time, if we see that they have a shortfall, then we'll try to restore it at that time. But right now, we're only needing the $19,082. And with this BA that just got approved before me, the $95,000, I kind of said, well, you know, where are we going to be in the commissioner's reserve? I kind of get concerned. Backing out the $3.6 million, that was debt service, this brings us down to the original budget for your emergency reserve was $500,000. We already took out the $89,000 for the DeWolf. That was like the first day of July. And there were some other items. But this actually will bring you down to about $315,000 if you back out the 3.6 of the debt service savings. So I'm still concerned because I think we had some other uses for it, like the $144,000 now, you know, for the CBDG, for the Three Oaks. And I know that'll be prorated. Whenever that is completed, but we also are coming up, starting to get cold outside. So, you know, we just need to be mindful of items that are coming out of it.
Thanks. Questions, anyone?
I move to approve the budget amendment using $19,082 of the Commissioner's Emergency Reserve to increase the Hurricane Joaquin Emergency Project OT-1620 budget for expenses incurred due to the storm and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related document.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
Thank you very much.
We're going to be seeing a lot of you now.
Okay.
Thank you, Commissioners. And this concludes County Administrator time.
Okay. Okay, next we're going to go right into the Department of Land Use and Growth Management decision on proposed CWSP water service category amendment for St. Anne's Anglican Church in Charlotte Hall. Mr. Shire and Mr. Chapman, welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. Mr. Chapman will be giving the presentation.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, this proposed amendment would provide for a future water service to property within the Charlotte Hall Town Center. Property is identified as 29530 Charlotte Hall Road, also known as tax map 4 parcel 316 in the 5th election district. The public hearing was held on October 20th, 2015. The record was held open for 10 days after that and closed on October 30th. During the public hearing, there was no public testimony offered, and during the open record period, we did not receive any further comment. So we're here for a decision today that would accommodate this service by changing the water service category to W3D for the property.
Where do we stand on this Charlotte Hall plan? We've been talking about a North County plan, whatever we're going to call that.
We have an RFP out for a traffic consultant, basically, on the presumption that traffic is the main problem that I've been hearing about, that everybody up there agrees upon. I have to get with procurement to find out where we are, but it was just recently put out. So
we've had a meeting with Metcom, and one of their concerns is, our concerns have been St. Clement Shores. And they're saying there's more bang for the buck, and they point to Golden Beach as an area that has a lot of... What I'm worried about is we continue to see this water change going on in this Charlotte Hall area. I think this is the second, if not the third one I've seen here last few months. Are we going to keep creeping along with, you know, one after another?
Well, that's the way the system is set up now for these individual parcels that are not of the adequate service category.
You have some more out there waiting to get on?
I would say every vacant parcel that has, you know, potential for development, yes. And it just so happens that Macaulay is a couple parcels away from this church.
Yeah.
And the church, I think it's coincidental that they just happen to apply in the same summer, you know, for development. We take it as they come unless we come up with some capital project to expand the water system.
I'd rather see us have a comprehensive plan than just start piecemealing here and there.
That will, of course, be factored into the comprehensive plan, but for the time being, I'm focusing on the traffic because that was what this consultant money was for that you granted us the 2016 budget year. So
I'm going to ask a question.
Yeah, one of the issues I have, I think I said it last time with the Macaulay property, is this is exactly what I feared happening. You know, we approved the Macaulay property coming across from the VA over there, and now we have the next property that's adjacent. And I think it's actually almost word for word, if we look back at that, what I said is that the next property, it's going to start having that trickle effect. And you know, where is it going to stop and how the hookup's going to go and who's going to be imposed by this as the homeowners that these pipes are running in front of now. And that's the biggest problem I have, is that we have the Macaulay property that was approved, and now we're going to have lines running in front of other people's property in the north end, and this is absolutely what they don't want without a comprehensive plan.
And actually that is not going to occur. I believe the church is going to, it's like the road is a ladder, and the rungs of the ladder will be crossing the street, so these new lines will not be fronting along any new properties.
Okay. So they're gonna run under the road.
Yeah.
Going under the road.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But again, that could be problematic if...
Right. Oh, yeah.
In the future.
Yeah. I understand. Any other questions, guys?
I have a question. Is the motion that was presented by your staff, it lists W3, but on your chart here, you're showing W3D. What is the designation?
The D. I left the D off. I'm sorry. That just implies that it's developer-driven.
Okay. I just want to make sure we did that correctly. I move that the amendments change the CWSP water service category to W3D for St. Anne's Anglican Church in Charlotte Hall be adopted as proposed.
Second.
All those in favor?
Hold on. Under discussion, I would say if you get any more applicants coming in, I'd like to hold off any more applicants till we get a plan up there. I don't know if we can do that, but that's...
That might be hard. Take the M word, as they say.
All right. Anyway, let's get a plan going.
I had a first and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have our county attorney. 2016 agenda for the joint meeting with St. Mary's County Legislative Delegation on November 17th, 2015.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Based upon the discussion last week, I did prepare and submit to you a proposed agenda that lists the different items that may be considered, and I grouped them under three categories. Those that are actual legislative proposals generated by the Board of County Commissioners, which include the holdover revisions of repealing obsolete parts of the county code. I did draft a provision that would impose term limits on members of the Board of Education. There's a second proposal that I drafted that would basically be enabling authority for the commissioners to adopt an ordinance dealing with the operation of golf carts on public highways. And in so drafting, I incorporated the limitations that are imposed upon low-speed vehicles under, I think, Section 211125, so I included a copy of that particular statute in your package. That's existing legislation. And finally, as directed, I prepared an amendment to the St. Mary's County Open Meetings Act that would deal with executive sessions. Under the second category, as noted last week, there are three requests for support from the Board of County Commissioners, being a series of proposals submitted by the Alcohol and Beverage Board. It's already been forwarded to the delegation. Charles County Commissioner President Murphy's request for support of his proposal to cover the cost of the care of abused animals. And Delegate Morgan's request for consideration of his proposal regarding personal property taxes. Likewise, the third category, if I understood direction from last week, was to list two additional topics as discussion items that might ultimately generate particular proposals. I know Commissioner Jarvo has since I believe we've received a copy of
House Bill 134.
A bill that was enacted for Charles County last year. The second topic of conversation would be the St. Mary's County Metropolitan Commission. I did note specifically, but without intending to limit the discussion, the two topics that I believe Commissioner Hewitt raised regarding bond amortization and the cost and financing of water and sewer connections. This is just a proposal before you. It's still subject to revision, additions, deletions, or a motion to approve the agenda, I guess, would be in order.
Just on the Open Meetings Act, I had a chance to read it. So it says that it's prohibited to disclose the information. However, there's no penalties attached to if you do. Is that highlighted somewhere else?
Yes, there's a separate section of St. Mary's County Open Meetings Act which provides for violation, a penalty for violation of any provision of the act.
Okay, so it references that.
I believe that's 9515, as I recall. I can get you a copy of that.
Thank you. The only other thing I have that was brought up was collective bargaining for the Fraternal Order of Police number 7. We did receive the letter of support from the Fraternal Order of Police requesting our support for the collective bargaining. Just for the other commissioners on this, I wanted to make some points, which right now there's 17 vacancies at the sheriff's office with 11 corrections. There's 10 in the academy. So at one point we had basically 38 vacancies of all the personnel. The 10 vacancies are from most likely recent people that turn over within the agency at a cost of $181,000 each to the county taxpayers. So essentially what that costs to the taxpayers for the vacancies because of turnover, et cetera, on one part is $4,887,000. To retrain the deputies that we've already spent the $181,000 on is a cost of $1,810,000. And it's roughly $1,320,000 to train the corrections and hire them. So overall, looking at it, the purpose of collective bargaining is to give a stable work environment. We already have the compensation study, so we know that coming back from the sheriff's office in this budget cycle, we're going to have a compensation study is how we're going to integrate the parallel pay across the board to make that even. Collective bargaining helps limit turnover. So if we look at the average turnover rate for a deputy within the sheriff's office, it's 3 to 5 years. So with that being said, if we broke it down, you don't recover your investment, even if it's at $36,000 a year. But meanwhile, when you look at Charles, Prince George's, Howard, Montgomery, Harford County Sheriff's Office, Prince George's County Sheriff's Office, and Greenbelt, their average retention is anywhere from 9 to 10 years. And at that point, most people are leaving the agency because of some cataclysmic life event. It's usually a severe medical injury or gross misconduct and being terminated. So you more than well recover all the funding that was put in from the taxpayers. On top of that, the money that we're wasting having to deal with this turnover can then go to apply to strengthen the force in the future. One of the other things to consider is we have a good sheriff now, and what happens in 2018? And we get random John Doe that has, no law enforcement experience, know nothing, and possibly has bad motives, but doesn't share that, runs for sheriff, gets elected. Then we have our staff that are here for 25 years that are subject to this constant change, or somebody that has no clue what they're doing and putting them through turmoil for those 4 years, changing everything. I mean, just totally disrupting the flow of the agency. This would give continuity regardless of who was elected into office, because there would at least be some set of operating procedures in place that you can't just go in there and turn everything upside down overnight and affect the personnel that are there for 25 years. I really think it helps with a morale position. It gives a sense of security. Beyond that, the biggest impact we have is to the taxpayers. We're going to be able to save money with this, actually, because we're not going to hopefully have this big turnover, based on the fact that people are going to feel safe in their positions. They're going to want to come to work. They're not worried about, the finer details or a sheriff that might get elected that knows nothing and turns everything over. I mean, I don't want to continue to lose our employees, or the sheriff's employees that we're funding, I should say, to agencies like Prince George's simply because there's a safety blanket there with collective bargaining, or Charles County, or any place else for that matter. I think it's a worthwhile endeavor to give some stability to these men and women that are out there in these times, and it'll definitely do a tax, save us some tax money in the future. I do. So I would like to see this go to the delegation. I would, put it to them to go ahead and turn down if they didn't want to bring it up there. But I think this board, with these numbers, should at least give it a shot to get to Annapolis that they haven't had in the past 8 years of trying. They've tried for 8 years to get it up there, and every single time it never makes it past this board. I'd at least like to try to get it to Annapolis.
So when we brought this up last week, I was pretty open in my sharing that, I talked with the FOP when I was running for office, and this was something that was mentioned to me, that they were very interested in the collective bargaining. My concern last week was we hadn't heard from them directly, but we did indeed receive a letter from their leader right after I made that comment, said, yes, we do want to move to collective bargaining, which to me was fine. I mean, that's the trigger that I needed to really get behind it. Working in the private sector, and I've never been a huge fan of unions and collective bargaining, but I will say there's certain types of employment activities where they do make sense. The teachers' unions make sense because we don't need teachers trying to negotiate their personal wherewithal individually, because we've empowered them, we've hired them to teach our students, and they need to spend their time focused on the classroom, so they need a representative voice. We have volunteer fire and rescue, so we don't have that need for salary because they don't draw one. But it's very common in the professional firefighting and paramedic industry as well to have a bargaining unit that represents their interest. And I would certainly say that in the areas of the police department, we need the men and women of our police department to be focused on law enforcement, not worrying about their paychecks and there being protections and other things like that. So for that approach, I am in support of taking this forward, and I think it's a good initiative. Thanks.
And I had to support it too, because I do believe it's something necessary. We don't need a police officer to be worrying about their job tomorrow. And if they got a problem, they should have somebody out there that can represent them. And I support it myself.
And you did include in your motion no binding arbitration, correct?
Yes, it's just collective bargaining. That's all that'll be going up.
Okay. So I said every 4 years at election time, the question gets asked, and then sort of fades away for four more years, and
yeah,
it comes back. Now, do you know if the if the FOP, you know, has formally voted on this in any of the recent meetings, or just is this is the election, when the election time comes and they ask us the question and it dies, have they, in any of the recent meetings, voted as a whole to support this, or did they, or because you brought it up and we got a letter 30 minutes later, that they actually were, you know.
The previous board voted to support it back when we were running for office. It never died. I do know that the letter I received was from Bill Raddatz. He's their legislative affairs officer. So he would not have been able to send the letter to us unless there was a consensus from the board, and the president went ahead and said, you know, yes, we need this letter to go to the commissioners. So it's not a rogue member sending a letter. They do have support from the board. I know they have support from the troops on the ground, so to speak, and the other members of the FOP. I can't say that I've ran across one deputy that is actually against it. If there is, you know, feel free to talk to your president or email us. But no, it's still a consensus from the board.
Okay. Yeah. I just want to make sure that democracy was in action, not monarchy.
Oh, yes. I don't think Mr. Raddatz would have sent us a letter unless the board was approving that. So, and I think it's going to carry over as well. They're having elections here soon again, so I don't think we're going to have to worry about them turning it down.
We do have an endemic issue, though, with the disparity between the police pay in our county and the correction officers with our neighbors. And collective bargaining by itself isn't going to solve that. But
true.
I mean, when we get this study that comes through, we're going to have to take a really hard look at that, because you make a great point, Commissioner Connor, that we're spending a lot of money training deputies that are just getting their law enforcement certification and bailing out
and
to another
somewhere
county.
Else.
And it is too expensive to have that kind of turnover. So even though there will be some associated costs, obviously, with increasing salaries and benefits in the future, they may be outweighed with the attrition issue that we're facing today. So this is something we're going to have to, as a board, really take a good look at.
Yeah, once it gets put in place, I mean, I truly appreciate the support, as I'm sure the FOP does. It's not going to happen overnight. Obviously, there have to be some negotiations that go on back and forth for the collective bargaining agreement. So if it does get approved by Annapolis, we're not talking an overnight thing here. There's a lot of steps that go into this and a lot of negotiation.
My initial reaction when I hear two terms, collective bargaining and compensation study, prices are going up. Mm-hmm. That's just my reaction, that this is going to cost us more money. So we have to be prepared. I'm not sure I got elected to do any collective bargaining. And I'm all about fairness. I've always been police friendly, and I want them to have everything they need. Just not sure I don't think I got elected to start any unions.
So I understand.
But again, you know, I'm sensitive to understanding the needs of our law enforcement and making sure they have what they need. So I'm still a little on the fence.
Well, I don't know if it helps with your decision, but the compensation study, obviously we put that in last budget cycle, and we should be anticipating, because there was a 9% disparity anyway, that the study is going to come back and say there's a 5-10% disparity in pay between all of these agencies. And I'm pretty confident that's going to be the case. So we're going to have to work out how we deal with that pay anyway. So it might be that we have to phase in. We're going to have to figure out prices are going to go up for the cost of having a deputy anyway. All I think with this is, with the cost going up for the deputy, we're ensuring the retention for the return on investment. So if we're paying more, they're not coming here for 3-5 years and then rolling out to Prince George's because, you know, they have a security blanket, so to speak, and they're getting the right pay.
All right.
That's.
I know that's a challenge for us.
Yes.
And I'll still say to you this. I can support the sheriff, the whole police force. I just don't know if I can support collective bargaining. So
right.
I need to tell you, I'm not there. I'd like to pivot. Do you have enough what you need for this, George, for this?
Yes, unless
I want to pivot.
Is there
a
will of the commissioners with respect to this agenda? Did you want to make it a discussion?
Showing no binding arbitration on this. That's the main thing. No binding arbitration.
Yeah, I'm not going for the binding arbitration right now. Just the collective bargaining. I mean, that's the first step. And
okay, what's the spirit of all of us? Are we supportive of this?
Well, it's got to go. We're presenting it to the delegation.
Well, I know that,
so even if we support, they can die.
I want to know that all of us support it. That we're heading that general direction.
I support it.
I support it.
Yep.
Do you need a specific proposal drafted?
We'll add that into our legislative proposals. We'll add that as part of the four we have here right now.
We can talk about it with the joint meeting.
Yeah. Well, what we're going to do is today we're going to vote on the specifically the proposals that we have, the others requests for endorsement and discussion that we're not really voting on that today.
Now, I think if you had to take any guide, Mr. Sparley, you'd be able to look at legislation enacted in Harford County because they have a sheriff's department. So I think it would be most similar in how they move forward with their union.
I'm a great believer in plagiarism.
And I think you'll get it there. But I name multiple counties here. I can provide them to you later. But they all have some sort of ordinance recognizing such and such. It's pretty straightforward. I can draft something,
circulate it to you by email. Do you want to consider it next Tuesday at your business meeting before or just go straight to the legislative hearing?
I think it's important that whatever we get should be shared simultaneously with the delegation. To have something that we get and change at noon, per se, and then all of a sudden the delegation has a piece of paper, we change it at noon, they walk in and say, what's going on?
Yeah, we've given the delegation the commitment as well as the commissioners that they'll get their packet on Friday.
We'd like to get it by Friday.
Okay. And this isn't the collective bargaining agreement. Obviously, you know, that is totally separate. I think the enabling legislation is very short and brief, actually. So I think it would just be, what does the enabling legislation look like that would have to go to Annapolis, maybe an example of that. But ultimately, that's most likely up to the legislative body to have their people draft the wording that would go into that.
Yes, I would suspect, and that's true basically of all these proposals, that they're the basis for initiating an action. If the delegation supports them, they will go through the sausage factory, I'm sure.
Right. Okay.
I will be glad to do that.
Hold on a second before we run off. On METCOM, what we had a discussion with the delegation about extending their bonds to 40-year amortizations. Currently, they're at 30-year amortizations. And if they go to 40-year amortization, it does give them the ability to hopefully lower rates to rate payers because they get a lower rate on their rates. Point is, if you have language that I'd like it to say up to 40 years. Now, in a discussion with Delegate O'Donnell, he said he introduced legislation for the state to do that, I guess, last year, and it was passed. So we would be mirroring what they're doing at the state level already. But it would be important that the language says up to 40 years. So in case it's something that they can do on a shorter amortization, it makes better sense that METCOM has that ability. Secondly, I firmly believe that the rates METCOM charges to hook up people, I've continually heard these stories, $45,000 to hook up, $110,000 to hook up, $200,000 to hook up, for people to hook up business accounts is keeping businesses from expanding. And I believe that if we can figure out a mechanism that allows that charge to hook up to be tied to a property tax, that it would allow that infrastructure improvement, which typically lasts 30 years to 40 years, that it could be amortized over a 30-year and go with the property. It would show up once a year on the property tax bill, and that's how it could be paid over time by the person who had it. Now, of course, if that person were to sell the business, God forbid, pass away, something like that, were to change ownership, it would continue to be the responsibility of the next owner of that property. It would be a mechanism to allow people to say, okay, I don't have to spend $110,000 so I can get $1,200 a month rent for this piece of commercial property. So I'd like to look at a mechanism for that. And lastly, I'd like to look at what it would take. Now, I'm not sure this is maybe more of a job for county government, Dr. Bridget, than legislators, what it would take if we were to bring METCOM into county governance. Now, Somerset County and St. Mary's County are the only two counties in the state to have this current setup where we're responsible for the full faith and credit of their debt, but we cannot influence their operating. I said yesterday at a meeting with the delegation, they spent $8.4 million to upgrade their meters. That's almost $500 per ratepayer. It'll take them 25, 30 years to get that return on investment. Plus, they want to spend money, $12 million, fixing the water system down at St. Clement Shores for 275 people. That's $41,700 per person to fix the water system down there. We need to get a handle on what they're spending their money on. So I'd like to know, I'm sorry, Dr. Bridges, probably more a question for you, is that what would be the mechanisms, what would be the impacts on county? Would George need more help with people? Would we need more staff if we brought them in?
We haven't done an analysis on if the governance structure changed. I think the question for me today would be, do you want to have that C discussion with the delegation about METCOM governance?
And my answer is seed discussion, yes.
I agree with you.
It would be a conversation that we can have. It may take several years to figure out.
Okay.
If I'm hearing this correctly, add that as an additional discussion item.
That would be under discussion item.
Right. That's yes. What I think I just heard a majority of the commissioners say.
I certainly don't mind having a conversation with the delegates about what that might look like to be more educated. But I can tell you right now, I don't see any evidence that bringing it under county government is going to improve performance. I don't see any evidence that METCOM is doing anything unusual with their spending. They've got good budget practices. And I don't see that the county government can say we wouldn't fix the water infrastructure in a particular area if it needs to be fixed, because they're the Metropolitan Commission. I think they use good, judicious processing in how they spend their money. So I certainly am not interested in going beyond an exploratory study.
And I can concur with Commissioner Charbo. So far in the years that we've listened, I haven't seen, you know, based upon where law was and how law was created back in the 70s or so by former Senator Raley, and the reason that METCOM was separated from county government for political reasons, that the influence couldn't be politically driven to keep METCOM, you know, sort of under a politician's thumb. And then all the things that they have had to do over the past few years. I mean, I agree with Commissioner Hewitt, the cost to hook up is bad. But when you add $39 million to the numerator for the Marley Taylor upgrade to, you know, meet state and federal mandates, and the denominator doesn't change, you know, we can all go back and do the math and see the rates are going to go up until they are able to obviously add more customers to that. And the studies that we've read and have been presented so far haven't shown to me anything that clearly shows that, you know, what they're doing, while it can be perceived as onerous, I haven't seen anything in those studies coming back that sits there and says they're doing something wrong financially. All the studies have said they're operating within their means and they're doing things they're supposed to do. And yeah, we're at a bad time right now. And I go back to that 2007 legislation that, you know, a lot of these homes were predetermined and didn't have to pay a hookup fee. And I use Wildwood as my example. Every house out there never has to pay a hookup fee because they were all platted pre-2007. And then you guys were at the Pembroke meeting, and three-fourths of those people were platted before 2007. So all those hookups, even if they're done today, if they were pre-platted, is no charge because of a preordained position. Now we're at the point that, you know, hookup fees keep going up, and they have to sit there as in METCOM and figure, okay, how do you pay for this kind of stuff when, you know, statute changed, and we're stuck with the new presidents, or businesses are stuck with the remnants of legislative actions that took place long before any of us sat here.
So I would say that kind of pivots back to the first discussion point you had on METCOM. Nobody here on this Board of Commissioners is suggesting that we should do nothing with METCOM. There is probably, we're going to really need to look at how we can affect the rate structure, because clearly it's onerous for businesses to expand. Clearly it's turning new business opportunities away from coming, and clearly there's a big outcry from the public who is served by the water and sewer system, that their rates are coming out of control. I'm a big believer that we're not going to get more users at an adequate pace to keep up. And if we don't, as commissioners, take some sort of action to help METCOM with this process, the rates will continue to rise. The building will be more onerous. But I don't believe we need to bring METCOM as part of the county government to do that. That's really the only difference.
But The other commissioners on this board, I'm sure, have received the same emails and calls I've had complaining that their rates have gone up dramatically. Homeowners' rates have gone dramatically in the last several months. And also, I've heard, hey, look, my water bill is higher than my electric bill. That's never been the case. I'm hearing that a lot from people. So it just, it's something that's coming out because they changed their rate structure.
You're 100% correct.
But it's nothing we can influence. We can't influence
that. So remember, this is the chicken and the egg syndrome that MetCom has. People sat here my last term and screamed, why should I be able to go to Florida for 6 months and I got to keep paying my rate and this is unfair. So MetCom actually answered the demands of the citizens who were complaining about, I shouldn't have to pay. Now they have to pay. And I've sat with MetCom and, you know, they've explained how all this works and it's going to take, and what they've explained to me, and I think you all heard it too, it takes a year to see, excuse me, if the way they designed this rate structure that started on July the 1st till the end of next June, if that system they've come up with to, you know, meet the demands of the public, which is don't make me pay for water, and then people are getting much higher water bills. I agree with you completely, but I think that the MetCom has to have time to prove or disprove. They have to either prove that they've done what is right, or we can sit there and say, you had your year, here's what you said you were going to do, it didn't work, what are you going to do now?
See, the issue to me gets to be the remunerator that you and Tom keep talking to, is that they have 17,000 customers, and any infrastructure improvement has to be spread out amongst that 17,000 payers. They're going to be paying for it. So when they want to come to the commissioners and say, hey, fellas, give us a hand here, you know, give us a grant or something so we can fix St. Clement Shores, I'm receptive to that. Where it makes me unreceptive is, okay, a good example is public schools. I don't have kids in school anymore, but I believe it's important that I give my share to public schools because I want educated children. But I also believe for me to give money to MetCom, because I want a better bay, I want a better river, I want cleaner water, I want treated effluent, I need to have some influence over their, not so much, that's the bad term. I like to be able to have input on their spending. Mm-hmm. So as we do at the Board of Ed, when they come in here, they want to talk about they need more teachers or they need more programming, technology, whatever. Look, we can yay and nay that stuff. We can't do any of that with MetCom.
I've agreed 90% of what you said. I think the biggest problem that we faced was this Marley Taylor upgrade. And one of the commissioners sat there and says, well, we're just not going to do it. And George, I think you were here, they sat there and said, well, that's fine because the federal government's going to fine you $100,000 a month unless you want to go to federal court and try to beat the EPA and all those guys. And I think, George, you sat here and you know the chance that you're going to go up there and argue to save the money. And quite frankly, it was a no-win situation the MetCom had because they said $100,000 a month is the penalty. And we knew, at least the last word, there's no way you're going to win that case in federal court. Or we're just going to drag on there and keep fining $100,000 a month till you were going to bite the bullet and put that upgrade in. So I can see where you're coming from, correct, but I mean, MetCom had no control over that Marley Taylor. We had no control over that Marley Taylor. And the unfortunate part about it is $39 million gets added to the numerator.
Okay, we use the term unfunded mandates, and that's something we can talk about. But I know we're getting late. We probably need to pivot off of MetCom.
And I agree with you. There's your answer. The unfunded mandates has caused all this problem from the state level. We know that. And I think we need to send this as a seed discussion with our delegation coming up.
Okay. Sounds like we'll add that to your agenda.
Yeah, so add that in as part of the agenda.
Mm-hmm, yes, sir. Okay. And then your motion on the table today is to, it sounds like, to send the five proposals on the agenda for the joint meeting. That's the motion, if you'd like to do it by motion or consensus.
Of the Code of St. Mary's County, St. Mary's County Board of Education and term limits, operation of golf carts on public roads, St. Mary's County Open Meetings Act, and the police collective bargaining. That number five?
Yes. We added that just
I'd only add as part of discussion that we are in the middle of working on some legislation. I'm working with the delegates right now, and I'm sharing it with the commissioners. It'll probably closely mirror House Bill 134 from the Charles County last year for tax incentivization for expansion of existing businesses and new businesses to relocate, trying to put some more tools in Chris Castellanos' toolbox. I'll be working with the CFO and with the delegation and with the Department of Economic Development
hopefully to have some draft language to you that we can put in the package by Friday so they have something.
And that'll be part of the outcome of the discussion part.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll put that in there. We'll have the HB 134, right?
I'm uncertain what I want to. Commissioner Jarbo is preparing a specific legislative proposal, such as
we're trying to prepare a specific one. Is a correct statement. So, however, at this point, we're tweaking language of one that has legal precedence that was approved last year at the state level, trying to see if it's something that is something that has teeth that would improve opportunities for businesses, that really does something, and also is palatable enough to pass through the General Assembly without being turned down.
Well, I guess my question then was, is this now become proposal six, or are we still just leaving it as a discussion item under?
I don't know that it matters. It can be a discussion.
I don't know anything about it.
It's got to be discussion.
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, okay, we'll put that under discussion.
Just keep it under discussion because we have plenty of time until the actual delegation, the General Assembly starts.
It's been a discussion. Okay.
It is something I don't want to lose sight of that we're actually working on.
On a note, because I wanted to say, Commissioner Hewitt, I agree with you. I definitely think it needs to be looked at through your whole line of discussion. And that's exactly, to your point, why I voted no for the CIP, because I just couldn't support what they were doing with the operating budget. You know, I looked at it that way, and I couldn't vote yes for the CIP when I'm looking at an operating budget that's going to be doing exactly what it's doing right now. So I wholeheartedly support the direction that you're moving with it. And
We need to get some control over the spending, no doubt, but we need to have further discussion with the delegates that we can do about whatever direction you go with this.
So just to recap, adding a collective bargaining proposal for the Sheriff's Department is item number five under legislative proposals.
Correct.
And adding C, governance under Metropolitan Commission under general discussion would be the revisions to the agenda. And other than that,
and HB 134.
Well, that's just a precedence reason. I just keep the discussion as you have
okay.
it. That's fine.
Then
yes, sir.
That's satisfactory.
Yes, it is.
Mr. President, I move to include the following proposals on the agenda for the joint meeting with the St. Mary's County Legislative Delegation on November 17, 2015, as presented before this board and previously stated.
We put numbers 1, 2, 3, 1, 2,
3, 4, and 5.
Thank you.
I have a motion.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
I'm voting no.
What's that, sir?
I'm voting no.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you, George. Okay, next we move right into commissioner's time, and I'm going to start with Commissioner Hewitt.
Oh, all right. Okay, this past Friday we had a meeting with METCOM, Maryland Department of Environment, Commissioner Guy and myself, and several members of staff. The topic was St. Clement Shores and what to do about the failing septic systems out there. METCOM has refused to let failing systems hook up, even though they do have some capacity, but they are bouncing against the metrics imposed by Maryland Department of Environment and could be fined for going above those metrics. I have to say we had a very good meeting. It was very productive. Ms. Lynn Buell, the Director of Water Management, came down along with four people from her staff. They were receptive to finding a solution to this issue. They actually visited the neighborhood. They went to a couple of people's homes out there, visited the site where the collection ponds could be. It was a good collaborative meeting. METCOM got to put their points out there, the county did, they did. And at the end of the day, they said some very good things about St. Mary's County. Ms. Buell came from EPA. She was there for 8 years, and now she's in MDE in Annapolis or Baltimore, wherever they may be. And her point was, is when she was on the federal level, they always looked at the states as the incubators for new ideas. Now that she's on the state level, she believes the counties are the incubators for new ideas. And the reason I bring that up is we in our counties understand our needs. We know our limits and we know the restrictions that are placed upon us by when we face a $10,000 a day fine. and we need some relief. We need some flexibility while we work our way through these challenges. We're hopeful that if we can take St. Clement Shores and use that as a model, as a pilot program, for what's going on in Golden Beach and McKay's Beach and Wicomico Shores, that we can help other parts of our county overcome this issue of failing systems that aren't hooked up, sewage that's seeping into the bays or the rivers unabated. So I'm hopeful that we will continue to see progress. They took maps from us, they took ideas from us, and they took them back up the road. We hope to hear back from them the next 60 days or hopefully sometime after the first of the year on a way to move forward. That's hopeful. That's progress. Secondly, we met with the delegation, Commissioner Guy and I, yesterday. And the topic was communication, that they want to know when we're going to propose things that have implications on state level. This joint meeting we're having next Tuesday night is an example of a greater collaboration that can take place between the delegation and the commissioners. They'd like to know if we're going to put money towards a building or if we're going to try and influence a state project down here, because they want to help. They want to be involved, and we want their help. So I'm looking for greater collaboration between the delegation and the commissioners, and more importantly, more open and transparent communication between us. Thank you.
Tom?
Thanks, Sue. First of all, I'd like to say happy birthday to all the devil dogs out there. It is the Marine Corps' 240th birthday today. This past weekend, we had an opportunity to go to the Hollywood Rescue Squad installation of officers. Interesting, Commissioner Hewitt and I sat next to each other because they go through the top 10 responders and how many calls they run a year. And it's amazing to me that people have literally registered greater than 350 calls in a year. That's better than almost a call a day, which is an extremely busy group of professional volunteers. And it's just amazing to me that our community, as a former EMT, IV tech, rescue squad guy, I can tell you that we would run, if to get 40 calls a year was just amazing that you'd have that volume. It's incredible, and a lot of it has to do with, obviously, the growth of our community over the past 10 or 15 years. So kudos to those volunteers, because the demands keep getting greater and they keep stepping up to the plate and getting the work done. Talked a little bit about business tax credit that we're trying to work on. Last year we sent, the commissioner sent a letter up to our delegation. All five of us agreed that we'd like to do a personal property tax exemption for small businesses. It was not received well. I did go up to the state and testified in Annapolis on behalf of that with Delegate Morgan. It was just killed in committee. It never went out for a vote whatsoever. At issue is that the state level, they really don't like tax exemptions. They don't mind tax credits. They don't mind tax abatements, but they really don't like the word exemption. So we're trying to recraft something a little bit different this time to go back up. And we're trying to craft something that would encourage new business to come into the community, would encourage current businesses to grow, and would be a win-win for both the county and the business by giving them some sort of abatement or incentivization without costing taxpayers money. So I think there's a way to work the magic. There was a success that was referred to, House Bill 134, that went up for Charles County last year, similar in nature, but it didn't have a lot of discussion in the actual legislation on how you would actually execute it. So we're going to be working with our neighbors over in Charles County to see if they've had an opportunity to put that forward, and is it something that has teeth, or is it a feckless waste of legislation? If the latter is the case, we're not going to worry about moving it forward, but I think we really need to continue to look at ways to increase business opportunities in St. Mary's County. On that topic, I would say keep paying close attention to what's going on at St. Mary's Airport. Some good things are really happening over there. We're getting ready to do our expansion, which is going to cause a little bit of pain for the people who are using the Higher Education Center and from Wildwood on that side. But the construction of new hangar space continues. We're getting more hangar space, which is going to be more opportunity to bring business into St. Mary's County in the areas of aircraft systems integration of new systems and technologies. And a pivot over to the third building, we constantly talk about the third building, the University of Maryland coming down, and we have this new college opportunity. That is not the point. The point is not about a college. The point is about a research center, and that is what is giving us the latitude that what we were struggling with Big Navy trying to do unmanned systems research in restricted airspace over a military installation those pains that we've been going through are now being alleviated to some extent because we have the University of Maryland system with a test site, with a COA, a conditional operations agreement, which will allow us to bring commercial UAS, RDT&E, research, development, design, test, and engineering here into our commercial airport space in limited capacity, but yet it's a step in the right direction. So pay attention to that because that is the opportunity of the future. Thank you.
Well, I'm still looking at the Tri-County Animal Shelter. There is some legislation that's going up. The Charles County is going to be hosting it for reimbursement of animals that are seized. So hopefully we'll be able to recover some funding that will help support the facility when we're seizing animals from those that aren't taking care of them properly, as well as looking at the overall facility and seeing what investment needs to be made to bring it up to standard through the CIP process. It is lacking in certain areas, so we continue to do that, and we will be looking at it, or at least I will be looking at it and talking with the other commissioners as to what funding we can do to make this happen. And it's something for the Tri-County as well. So if we're going to put up funding, we have to work with Charles, and Commissioner President Guy has been working with President Murphy and trying to find out what that funding is going to look like and what things really need to be identified to bring that up. So that, although I haven't been speaking about it often, it is still there, it's still on my list, and I'm still proceeding forward with it to see what we can do. I definitely believe in the communication with the delegation. However, I do believe communication is a two-way street. It's give and take. So what I would like to see as well is that the communication comes down as well as up. This is not a situation of privates and the generals. We're all colleagues, and we need to work together and communicate back and forth on that level. So I think that, it is a two-way street, and I'm more than happy to do that, but, I guess if you want to look at it, it's a quid pro quo type situation. You communicate that way, but it has to flow down as well as up. I am going to be putting in a formal opinion to the Ethics Commission for myself. Basically, I recused myself so far of any talks of automated speed enforcement and red light enforcement. There has been some coverage on that where the reason is I've consulted for the agencies, I've used the equipment as a police officer, and in my current capacity, I am an operating officer, so for a company. However, through this process, I want to make sure that I can actually talk about it, because being in the industry, being there and having the expertise and being recognized as a court expert on these devices, I think it's important to this commissioner panel that they have the best advice that they can possibly get from somebody that's been there. And I'm hoping, we'll see what the Ethics Commission says and what bounds and guidelines they give me. They may tell me to just sew my lips shut on the matter and move on. Who knows? But I want to get a formal opinion, and I want to have it in writing from them, and I think that's the best process to do it by. That's why we have them, so I will be pursuing that. I had a chance to go to Soderle Wine Festival. Apparently, Commissioner Guy was there just after me. It was more like Woodstock at some point with all the mud, but it was a very nice event. It was chilly and rainy, but they had a great turnout, so I enjoyed the time there. It's always great. The staff there is amazing, and they do such a great job with everything that they have to work with. And most of all, I'd like to say Happy Veterans Day. It's coming up to all my fellow soldiers, sailors, Marines, airmen out there. It's a great day. We recognize all our veterans, and I just want to give a shout-out to my friend Sean Wynn. Served in Iraq with him. He's currently in Utah. He went through a lot of this stuff with me, and also would unusual to usually thank a reporter publicly, but Jason Babcock did an amazing job in the Veterans Day edition. It is extremely difficult to take the experiences of a veteran that was in combat and put them in two pages in a certain amount of words with a certain amount of ink that you have to write with and convey it in the manner that it was told and with the emotion that's behind it and various other things to tell the story in such a manner. Thank you. I received a lot of calls and compliments. You told the story amazing, and I read Commissioner Guy's as well, and it was just amazing, the rest of the stories as well. So thank you very much for taking the time to listen to my experiences and putting it down on paper so eloquently. Thank you very much for sharing that with everyone. Hopefully there's a veteran out there that reads it and sees something about Operation Tojito as well. And with that, I'm looking forward to being in Leonardtown in the Veterans Day Parade. And seeing old Gavin Phelan, he wants to try and run up with us real quick in his flight suit. So he might come up. But either way. Commissioner Morgan.
Hey, thanks. I want to say it was a nice Hollywood Volunteer Rescue Squad ceremony. And sadly, I got there before you guys did. So I was there before. I was there when the mud was just starting. But I got out before the tractors were pulling people out. I was in by 12, out by 1, so that Commissioner Hewitt, Commissioner Jarbo, and I could attend Daniel Lothrop's Eagle Scout ceremony down in Ridge this past Tuesday. So that was a nice event for everybody to attend. We were late this morning because we all attended a panel discussion or a discussion by the Tuxedo Partnership on BRAC. And it was chaired, or the guest speaker was the General Counsel for the what's called the American Defense Communities Association, which is ADC. And that is a group of concerned communities that are affected by DOD movements. And it was rather sobering, and we've heard the BRAC word for a number of years. But what counsel told us today is that there are certain steps that precede the formal initiation of a BRAC. And we've heard the BRAC sounding for a long time. Well, what he did tell us today is that in the authorization bill that the president previously vetoed, which the president is going to pass now that they've come up with a budget deal, is that the three main criteria to begin the BRAC analysis, which is analysis of force structure, which is analysis of a 20-year operating plan for DOD, and a study on excess base inventory and capacity, is in the authorization bill. And there will be a report due 60 days after the authorization bill is signed, where Congress will ask for these three studies. So for anybody that thinks that the studies haven't started and the analysis hasn't begun, when the language was written over the summer, I think that we have got to focus now on what we're doing around here now. We have to focus on the fact that the BRAC language is out there somewhere, and with the authorization bill asking for the first three issues, which really then leads to the discussion of BRAC, I think that we as the commissioners are very mindful of that. I think the community should be mindful of the fact that this is real. And I know a lot of people sit there and say, you know, this is the chicken little, the sky is falling, but I'm afraid it's not falling. We've waited a number of years since the last BRAC in 2005, and, you know, whether it be an odd number, as they said, and it's going to be an odd number year when there's not a senatorial or a presidential election, because the House is every 2 years. So 17 or 19 sound like more palatable numbers for years right now. So I just think that is something that we all have to be concerned about and aware of. And I appreciate the partnership having the discussion this morning. And we have probably had about 100 people there to listen. I see Dick and Jason are both here. They were both present. So they'll be reporting on this, I'm sure, in a very current edition of their papers. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, I'll tell you right now, I'm feeling very good. I look forward to the Veterans Day Parade tomorrow. I will be there and marching with the rest of the commissioners and the other delegations as they come out there. And I want to express to myself, too, as a veteran, and Jason, that was a very good article you made up. I appreciate it. It was very good, very well done. And to all the veterans out there, please, tomorrow, I understand the parade at Leonardtown is going to be bigger than ever. Connie Pennington emailed me about a 300-plus additional participation as far as floats and personnel, so it's going to be huge. It was already big enough as it was, but it's going to be a heck of a showing to support our veterans. And for those of you see a veteran, the only thing you got to say is thank you. That's all we ever require. And it's hard to get anybody. I know my years, I've talked to various veterans in the American Legion about their experiences. And we have veterans back in, not anymore, World War I, two ones left, but Korea that just don't want to talk about it. And it's hard sometimes to even talk about it. And I appreciate Jason coming over and taking our testimony, especially from myself and John. It was very nice, very well done. Once again, about the BRAC thing this morning, I took away something even, and Todd has pretty highlighted all the things, and of course that's a concern for us as always, but one thing that he sort of keyed on that I think we've got a big handle on is our education. He mentioned about something about the local education, where some of the military, especially commanders, keen on. They want their troops to be taken care of, and I can remember that myself as my when I was in the military. We thought about the local community, and the big thing was that you leave your family behind as you're deployed somewhere, and they're going to school, and your wife's taking care of them, or your husband, and you're gone. And you worry about things like that, and so you want this good thing. And he definitely brought that up as one big point. Education was very important, that we have a good education. I think we've got one in this county now. We just need to preserve that and keep it going. Very important. As far as Soderle, wow, did I get there at the wrong time? Now, I was impressed over. I did sample some. I'm a red wine drinker. I really don't like any sweet wines too much. And there was this guy from Salisbury, Maryland. I don't know if you sampled that wine. But I thought it was red wine he had. And I thought, this can't be from the Eastern Shore. No way. But it was absolutely delicious. And, of course, he claimed it was his own grapes that he'd grown. And to produce a red wine on a southern or an eastern coast of any down here in the southern part, most of this muscatels and whatever, you know, you don't get any good wines. But he had a very good wine. So you missed that, but I got to admit, I came back. My wife looked at my feet and my bottom of my feet, my trousers, and I just had mud all over me. It was just unbelievable. Yeah, but everybody was there. It was a good crowd turned out, surprisingly. So I think those who did come, and those who didn't come, you missed a pretty good wine tasting of Maryland wines. After that, we got a break right now. We don't have very much time here. Our general session for the budget will start at in about 10 minutes.
Commissioner, would you like to delay the start so you have about 25 minutes for lunch and do 1:45?
Okay. Let's go, 1:45?
If that's your pleasure, that gives you enough time. Yes. 1:45.
Okay, we're going to take a recess until 1:45 and we'll start our budget process.
Thank you.